So the new unit we will start today is computing research methods. Yeah, and basically the research methods unit is being taught at different levels, like in level 5, level 6, maybe level 7, and is being taught in any field, like in computing, in business, in sociology, or anywhere, because the research can be done in any of the field. So being a researcher or the higher level student, one should know most of the research methods, techniques, no matter if it is the computing or the non-computing, but you should have some core understanding of the research methods, and you should learn that how to do the research. So most of the topics in this unit, they are related with all kind of the research methods, and obviously you have been asked to go through a research topic in the computer science. So let me go through. What is research? The systematic investigation and study of materials and sources in order to establish facts and reach new conclusion. So you investigate systematically the study of materials and sources in order to reach and establish certain facts and reach new conclusions. So the systematic is rigorous is basically the extremely thorough and careful investigation. So when you really go into the depth of any topic of a situation or problem in order to generate a new knowledge or validate existing knowledge. So when you study some topic, any people or any concept or anything, so what you will get, probably you would get a new knowledge from it. Maybe somebody has found it or not, or probably you can validate the existing knowledge. For example, you say that if you want to prove that a theory XYZ is true or not, like you might have heard mathematical equations, you sometimes prove any concept or formula by, let's say, providing left hand side is equal to right hand side, or with some assumptions, and then you say hence prove. Have you done before?
Yeah
In physics and something like that. So research is basically the either you get a new idea, or you, when you try to prove that the idea or validate the knowledge, then it's again the research. So it gave you knowledge, it helped you to get the things validated, and then you become the researcher. So idea is behind this, that probably in your course, in your study, you might be doing the existing research, or maybe you will be doing the new research. Whatsoever, it will enhance your knowledge through detailed investigation. Now research techniques, normally there are many, but we will discuss some of them. One is the applied research. Refers to scientific study and research that seeks to solve the practical problems. So applied research, as the name implies, you apply some research to the practical problems. It is used to find the solutions to everyday problems, for example, to cure illness and develop innovative technologies, rather than to acquire knowledge for knowledge sake. For example, applied researchers may investigate ways to improve the agriculture, cultural crop production, treat or cure a specific disease, improve the energy efficiency of homes, offices, or modes of transportation, or whatsoever, anything that you directly apply some your research findings or do the research to give some application. Make sense?
Yeah.
Then, basic research, also called as fundamental or pure research, is driven by a scientist's curiosity or interest in a scientific question. The main motivation is to expand man's knowledge, not to create or invent something. So when you do some basic research, it doesn't mean to, you know, create anything new, for example, but the motivation is to expand the knowledge. Yeah, that is called the basic research. There is no obvious commercial value to the discoveries that result from the basic research. So normally, if the, for example, you might have heard, you know, that in order to prove a single line of mathematics, for example, like scientists took their ages to solve it. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. So basic research may not give any direct benefit to any applied research, but still, you know, is the research. For example, basic science investigations probe for answers to questions such as how did the universe begin? Yeah. What are protons, neutrons, and electrons composed of? How do slime models reproduce? What is the specific genetic code for fruit fly or whatsoever? So just, you know, giving the answer to, you know, giving answers to particular simple questions, obviously it is not easy. Yeah. But research for the sake of knowledge. Yeah, that's it. So basic research and the earlier one was the applied research. When you apply something to in order to produce or solve some problem with some application. Yeah. Then correlational research refers to the systematic investigation or statistical study of relationships among two or more variables, without necessarily determining cause and effect. It seeks to establish a relation, association, correlation between two or more variables that do not readily lend themselves to experimental manipulation. For example, to test the hypothesis, listening to music lowers blood pressure levels. So there are two ways of conducting research. Experimental, for example, group samples and make one group listen to music and then compare to the BP levels. For example, so we are talking about the correlational research. Music is one variable and the blood pressure is another variable. For example, how you can prove this hypothesis? You take a group, you know, people, a group of people as a sample, you let them listen to the music and then check whether the BP is, you know, reduced or not. Another way is take survey, ask people how they feel, how often they listen, and then compare. Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. Advantages of correlational research: can collect much information from many subjects at one time, can study a wide range of variables and their interrelations, study variables that are not easily produced in the laboratory. Yeah. Disadvantage is correlation does not indicate causations, causes and effects, and problems with self-reported methods. Yeah, because these are the, that's, you know, the relational research. So really depends, at some point you have a way to get some advantage, and obviously some are, you know, disadvantages as well. Yeah, so when you do the correlational research, then you don't know what is the reason behind. That's the disadvantage. Yeah, so obviously we are not we cannot go directly into the, I mean, in depth of these, you know, topics, but let us give a kind of, you know, superficial definitions. Yeah.
Yeah.
And as the names are, they are self-explanatory already, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. Descriptive research. Research refers to the research that provides an accurate portrayal of the characteristic of a particular individual, situation or group. Descriptive research, also known as statistical research. These studies are means of discovering new meaning, describing what exists, determining the frequency with which something occurs, and categorizing information. In short, descriptive research deals with everything that can be counted and studied, which has an impact of the lives of the people it deals with. For example, statistical research is like, you know, how people, you know, behave, how many number of people, you know, do that particular things. For example, finding the most frequent disease that affects the children of a town. So you would be doing the research on the basis of some statistics. Yeah, the reader of the research will know what to do to prevent that disease. Thus, more people will live a healthy life. So from the statistics, yeah, from the past, when you did the research, it will benefit, you know, to audience, yeah, to people, whatever is described into the research, yeah, they will get a benefit. For example, it means the people who will live healthy life, they haven't done the research, but out of the descriptions of the research, people will get benefit. Yeah, like, you know, vaccination of, let's say, polio. Everyone knows that if you will not get the immunization vaccinations to your children, then you will get a serious diseases. Yeah, so how they are being, you know, operated, like, you know, they rely on the descriptive research. Yeah?
Yeah.
Advantages, the people, individual studied are unaware, so that they act naturally or as they usually do in everyday situation. Obviously, so whoever they study, yeah, if they are unaware, so normally they will, you know, get the benefit from it. It is less expensive and time consuming than quantitative experiments, collects a large amount of notes from detailed studying, as it is used to describe and not make any conclusions. It is to start the research with it. So you have some, you know, predefined or pre-research material in front of you, that's easy. Yeah, but it is the start. Yeah, you can do further research, but you have something in hand. Disadvantage, this descriptive research requires more skills. So nobody can say that, okay, I have found this disease, and this disease, for example, may be treated, you know, now, otherwise, after 200 years, for example, nobody will be living on the earth. Yeah, so it is very difficult. Does not identify cause behind a phenomena. Response rate is low in this research. Results of this research can change over the period of time. Yeah, so simply, just, you know, few of the points on the fingers. You know, like advantages and disadvantages. the name itself, descriptive research, is self-explanatory, and we did the example. Yeah.
Yeah.
Ethnographic research refers to the investigation of a culture through an in-depth study of the members of the culture. It involves the systematic collection, description, and analysis of data for development of theories of cultural behavior. It studies people, ethnic groups, and other ethnic formations, their ethnogenesis, composition, resettlement, social welfare characteristics, as well as their material and spiritual culture. Data collection is often done through participant observation, interviews, questionnaires. So ethnographic is also known as the anthropology, yeah, like dealing with social sciences, yeah. So how anything related with the social sciences, obviously with, you know, their settlement, their social deeds, their material life, yeah, their spiritual, their culture, their religion, yeah. So how normally you do this research? You observe the participants, you interview them, you question them. So that's called the ethnographic research. The purpose of ethnographic research is to attempt to understand what is happening naturally in the setting and to interpret the data gathered to see what implications could be formed from the data. So whatever, what they do, you normally take the interpretation that what it does mean. Then experimental research is an objective, systematic, controlled investigation for the purpose of predicting and controlling phenomena and examining probability and causality among selected variables. Advantages: best establishes cause and effect relationships. Disadvantage: artificiality, feasibility, unethical. How? So when you do an experiment, now we are coming to the experimental research. So obviously it means it would be a kind of laboratory research. Yeah?
Yeah.
You need to achieve an objective systematically and through controlled investigation for the purpose of predicting and controlling phenomena and examining probability and causality among selected variables. So advantage is that you can know the cause and effect. For example, if you are increasing one variable, for example, if you are increasing one particular item or ingredient, then you know that what you will get in on the other end. Yeah. For example, if you are making any medicine, then you would know that after adding that particular, you know, thing into the medicine, you will get these effects. Yeah. So you will have the direct kind of establishment, you know, established relationship between the cause and the effect. But the disadvantage, you are doing a kind of artificial thing within the laboratory. Yeah. Feasibility may not be good enough because it is in-house research kind of. Maybe you don't have the sufficient, you know, the experiments, the experimental tools, yeah, maybe cost effective. Unethical, like, you know, if you are doing any experiment inside the, you know, laboratory, for example, if you are doing, for example, the gene cloning, yeah, then probably that might not be, you know, ethical to do so. Yeah. So certain ethics can also be involved. The simplest experimental design includes two variables and two groups of participants. For example, the two variables could be independent versus dependent variables. The independent variable is the predictor variable, whereas the dependent variable is the outcome variable. The researchers manipulate and control the independent variable to study its effect on the dependent variable. Example of variables in scientific experiments. If a scientist conducts an experiment to test the theory that a vitamin could extend a person's life expectancy, then the independent variable is the amount of vitamin that is given to the subjects within the experiment. This is controlled by the experimenting scientist. So you have a vitamin, you have a life of a person, then one thing is depending on the other. So that is an experiment, yeah, you do that, how vitamins, you know, affects on the man's life. Yeah. Probably there could be any other things that you will be doing the research, the experimental research, then you will be dealing with the dependent variable and then the independent variable, right?
Yeah.
We are just, you know, doing the superficial theories, yeah, which has a kind of keywords that you can just understand from the words, and you know that what would be involved, and really depends when you will be doing a kind of, you know, real research, then you will be using these terms, you know, many times, and you would be really dealing with those terms, and you know, again and again, and then you will have a variety of information regarding this method, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, experimental research continued. So, we discussed the two variables, then two groups of participants, like control versus experimental group. The before beginning the experiment, the researcher randomly assigns his or her sample to two different groups, the control group and the experimental treatment group or clinical group. The control group receives no manipulation of the independent variable, no treatment, whereas the experimental group receives the manipulation of the independent variable. Yeah. So, as I explained, that highlights of the experimental research is that you select some two variables and then you select a group. You are applying on one group and you are not applying on the another group research. So that would work in this way, right? For example, if you want to prove something that you are, for example, you have created a vitamin, and so the variables will be vitamin increase the person's age. How you would prove? You would say here is the 30 people who took the vitamin. That's one person out of group. And here is the, you know, let's say 70 people didn't take the vitamins, another group. So you observe that 30 people, you know, survived 5 years more than the one who didn't, you know, use it, right?
Yeah.
Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now, next is the exploratory research, is a type of research conducted for a problem that has not been clearly defined. Exploratory research helps determine the best research design, data collection method, and selection of subjects. These results of exploratory research are not usually useful for decision making by themselves, but they can provide significant insight into a given situation. Exploratory research is not typically generalizable to the population at large. Exploratory research can be quite informal, relying on secondary research such as reviewing available research in literature and our data, or qualitative approaches such as informal discussions without consumers, employees, management or competitors, and more formal approaches through in-depth interviews, focus groups, projective methods, case studies, or plot studies. So, exploratory research is a type of research conducted for a problem that has not been clearly defined. Yeah. So, you want to determine, to design a data collection method and a selection of subject. So, anything which has not been clearly defined in before, you do a kind of research to explore it furthermore. Remember it, you rely on the secondary research. So, something has already been researched and you want to explore it more, which has not been clarified before. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Ground theory research is a research approach designed to discover what problems exist in a given social environment and how the persons involved handle them. It involves formulation, testing, and reformulation of propositions until a theory is developed. Ground theory is a research method that operates almost in a reverse fashion from traditional research, and at first may appear to be in contradiction to the scientific method. Four stages: codes, identify anchors that allow the key points of the data to be gathered. Steps, collections of codes of similar content that allows the data to be grouped. Categories, broad groups of similar concepts that are used to generate a theory. Theory, a collection of explanations that explain the subject of the research. So the ground research, theory research, is a research approach designed to discover what problems exist in a given social environment and how persons involved handle it. So, ground theory is determining the problems in social environment, which has not been done through traditional research. For example, somebody said, you know, that the contaminated water in particular area is due to the environment, or let's say that there is no any good water, for example, coming from the earth or from the mountains. Yeah, but is that research, you know, really true? You would need to go through the ground theory research. Probably, you know, you go and see the things in person and see the people, how, you know, people say probably there might be the other reasons. People use may not do any good cleaning. They might, you know, contaminate the water by themselves instead of the research that you see. Make sense?
Yeah.
So, by using these four stages like codes, concepts, categories and theory, you apply and then try to go through the conventional research, yeah, in a reverse fashion, then you do some kind of ground theory research. So, you have a theory, but you are going into the depth of the problem and see how it works, yeah? Historical research is a research involving analysis of events that occurred in the remote or recent past. Its application is historical research can show patterns that occurred in the past and over time, which can help us to see where we came from and what kind of solutions we have used in the past. Understanding this can add a perspective on how we examine current events and educational practices. the steps involved in conduct of historical research are identification of research topic and formulation of research problem question, data collection or literature review, evaluation of materials, data synthesis, report preparation or preparation of the narrative exposition. So historical research is based on the analysis of events that occurred in remote or recent past, right? As the name implies, yeah. Historical research gives a social scientist better context for making realistic decisions. Its strengths are provides a comprehensive picture of historical trends, uses existing information, provides evidence of ongoing trends and problems. Limitations, time consuming, resources may be hard to locate, resources may be conflicting, may not identify cause or problem, because it would be very old. For example, if you go 5,000 years, back, then you might find some symptoms, you might find some findings about something living like a dinosaur, or maybe 10,000 years ago, you might find dinosaurs, but you don't know that, there's no any proof that what they were and how they came, and many more things. There are certain limitations, yeah, and information may be incomplete, obsolete, inconclusive or inaccurate. Yeah,
yes.
Makes sense.
Yes, sure.
Data restricted to what already exists. Phenomenological research, an inductive descriptive research approach developed from phenomenological philosophy. Its aim is to describe an experience as it is actually lived by the person. Phenomenology is concerned with the study of experience from the perspective of the individual, bracketing taken for granted assumptions and usual ways of perceiving. They are based in a paradigm of personal knowledge and subjectivity, and emphasizes the importance of personal perspective and interpretation. As such, they are powerful for understanding subjective experience, gaining insights into people's motivation and actions, and cutting through the clutter of taken for granted assumptions and conventional wisdom. So phenomenal research, an inductive descriptive research approach developed from phenomenological philosophy. Its aim is to describe an experience as it is actually lived by a person. For example, so phenomena, any philosophy, yeah, if you want to prove, then you will be doing phenomenological research, any philosophy, yeah. So that's the idea about the phenomenological research. Let me go further, because this is going into too much theoretical, isn't it?
Yeah,
and it is making us the psychologist and other persons.
Yeah.
Okay, so let us come to the actual. On a broader perspective, all research can be classified into two groups, qualitative and quantitative. Are you clear about the do you know what is qualitative and quantitative?
Yeah.
Can you tell me what it is?
Quantitative is talking about research in number.
Yeah.
Why why qualitative is talking about the quality of research process.
Qualitative is related with a kind of belief, theory, yeah?
Yeah, but quantitative is just like the quantitative analysis.
Like, and qualitative is related with a belief, theory, yeah? Idea, yeah?
Yeah, ideas and maybe with quantitative is about empirical numbers.
Yeah.
It has to be about numbers and about figures.
Okay. So the qualitative research is dealing with phenomena that are difficult or impossible to quantify mathematically, such as belief, meaning, attribute, and symbol. Yeah. Qualitative researchers aim to gather an in-depth understanding of human behavior and the reasons that govern such behavior. The qualitative method investigates the why and how of decision making, not just what, where, and when. Yeah. So when you want to know why, yeah, the reasons behind, the idea behind, the belief behind is basically the qualitative. Yeah. Advantages: it enables more complex aspects of a person's experience to be studied. Fewer restrictions or assumptions are placed on the data to be collected. Not everything can be quantified or quantified easily. Individuals can be studied in more depth. So if you can't, you know a person very well, very exactly, then you can do a kind of qualitative study on a person. Yeah. Good for exploratory research and hypothesis generation. The participants are able to provide data in their own words and in their own way. Disadvantage: it is more difficult to determine the validity and the reliability of linguistic data. So you did the qualitative research, yeah, but it is somehow difficult to determine and validate and its reliability, that whether it is 100% true or not. However, in quantitative research, you really depend on the kind of percentage of the, let's say, validity and reliability of anything. But in the qualitative, you are not sure. There is more subjectivity involved in analyzing the data. So if you want to analyze anything, then you should have more subject knowledge. Data overload, open-ended questions can sometimes create lots of data which can take a long time to analyze. So, do you know what are the open-ended questions?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yes.
So, like it says in qualitative research, if you want to have a questionnaire survey and you have given a open-ended questions like, you know, the answer is given by the researcher. You haven't given the four answers to the not a researcher but the sample, a person whom you want to research. So if they give an open-ended question, then it would be a lots of data for you, then you need more time to analyze it. That's why, so that these are the advantages and disadvantages of the qualitative research. It's time consuming as well. Now we come to the quantitative research. It refers to the systematic empirical investigation of any phenomena via statistical, mathematical, or computational techniques. The objective of quantitative research is to develop and imply mathematical models, theories, and/or hypotheses pertaining to phenomena. Qualitative research is generally made using scientific methods, which can include the generation of models, theories, and hypotheses, the development of instruments and methods for measurement, experimental control and manipulation of variables, collection of empirical data, modeling and analysis of data, evaluation of results. So purely a kind of scientific and mathematical research is basically the quantitative research. where you talk about model theory and hypothesis. Yeah, you use some instrument and methods, you manipulate the variables, you collect empirical data from the experiments. Yeah, you analyze the data, yeah, and you evaluate the results. While in quantitative research, you don't have that kind of data in front of you. Quantitative research advantages: the quantitative research allows the researcher to measure and analyze data. The researcher is more objective about the findings of the research. Quantitative research can be used to test hypotheses in experiments because of its ability to measure data using statistics. So hypothesis is basically like you have to say something. For example, the reasons of, you know, increasing temperature on the earth is due to, you know, the not due to less number of trees in the world, for example. Yeah, then you probably, you know, you want to prove the hypothesis, yeah, for example, using certain data. Make sense?
Sure.
Disadvantage: the main disadvantage of quantitative research is the context of the study or experiment is ignored. Are you clear? What is hypothesis?
Yeah, I know hypothesis.
Can you explain to me?
Hypotheses are like theories that are not yet scientifically proven.
Sorry?
Hypotheses are theories about a certain experiment or research that has not been accepted by the scientific community as laws. Because there is a difference between, in science we have laws and we have hypotheses.
Yeah, but that's the one, you know, definition. But hypothesis is basically, you want to do something, you want to prove something.
Yeah.
Maybe, for example, if you say 1 + 1 = 2, yeah, when you say that, you know, or in other words, let's say 1 + 1 = 2, then when you would try to solve this hypothesis, then your research would be failed. Yeah. What is the hypothesis? 1 + 1 = 2. Okay. When you would come with the findings, then your outcome will be different. Okay. Then it means you concluded that the hypothesis is wrong. For example, yeah. Or in other words, when you wanted to add 1 + 1 = 2, and when you really added it, then you proved it that it is true. Make sense?
When you prove a hypothesis, it becomes a law.
Yeah.
But that's so, what I said.
Yeah. So in
when
I mean,
this is proven,
yeah,
it becomes a law.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah. And for example, means when you want to prove, in either case, you take the hypothesis as a, you know, contradiction, and make it as a, you know, the affirmation, yeah, and make it prove that it is not a contradiction. Or maybe when you say that it is the false, then you try to make it false. When you say that it is true, when you try to make it false, then you would get, you know, the your results. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So really, you really depends that how you want to prove the hypothesis. Yeah. So okay, let us go further into the slides. Yeah. So what it says that quantitative research can be used to test a hypothesis in experiments because of its ability to measure the data using statistics. So hypothesis, for example, is 1 + 1 = 2. That is a hypothesis. Yeah. So in different ways you can do the experiment and you can prove it whether it is true or not.
Yeah.
Main disadvantages of the quantitative research is the context of the study or experiment is ignored. So irrespective of the context, what you are talking about, you need to focus on only numbers. Quantitative research does not study things in natural setting or discussing the meaning things have for different people. A large sample of population must be studied for more accurate results. Now, so that was about the simply the quantitative research and qualitative research. What we have to understand is that quantitative research would be dealing with the numbers and the qualitative research would be dealing with the ideas, beliefs. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the next is the desk research, also known as secondary research. Yeah. So what does it mean? What does mean the secondary research?
Trying to build on a already made research, maybe.
Yeah.
Trying to expand on a research already made.
Yeah.
Or hypothesis already proposed.
Yeah. So secondary research involves the summary, collection and or synthesis of the existing research rather than a primary research in which data are collected from, for example, research subject or experiment. In other words, gathering and analyzing information already available in print or published or internet is the desk research. Focus group is a form of qualitative research in which group of people are asked about their perceptions, opinions, beliefs and attitudes towards a product, service, concept, advertisement, idea or packaging. Questions are asked in an interactive group setting where the participants are free to talk with other group members. During this process, researcher either takes notes or records the vital points he or she is getting from the group. Simple. Should I go further?
No, I think it's okay.
Is it clear? Yeah.
On the focus group?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's clear.
Interview. We are doing it. So when you do a focus group, when you interview someone, it's a research. An interview is a conversation where questions are asked and answers are given. In common parlance, in phrasing, the word interview refers to a one-to-one conversation with one person acting in the role of interviewer and the other in the role of the interviewee. Simple interview, you ask the questions, you are doing research. Yeah, I'm going to the next slides so that online research community is a part of an emerging and developing area in market research, making use of development in web 2.0 technologies and online communities. They allow qualitative research to be conducted efficiently and deeply online. Both public and private online communities offer opportunities for research, but many brands are way of sharing company information openly. Simply, you have a research, you do some research with the help of online research community. That's it. Mobile search is one kind of a research technique, is an evolving brand of information retrieval services that is centered on the convergence of mobile platforms and mobile phones that can be used to tell information about something and other mobile devices. Web search engine ability in mobile form allows users to find mobile content on websites which are available to mobile devices on mobile networks. So as this happens, mobile content shows a media shift towards mobile multimedia. Simply put, a mobile search is not just a partial shift of PC web search to mobile equipment, but is witnessing more of tree-like branching into specialized segments of mobile broadband and mobile content, both of which show a fast-paced evolution. So basically, these are not the kind of, you know, the well-known research techniques, yeah, but the mobile itself has become a kind of research. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Now everyone thinks about the mobile, yeah, and you want to do something new into the mobile every time. Nowadays, like a mobile has become the research, oh, I want to do something on the mobile, I want to make an application on the mobile, like a app, yeah, to do something. So everybody thinks about the mobile to do something into new, to make a business, to do the invention and these things. So this is about the everything researching into the mobile itself. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Yeah. Survey, a method of sociological investigation that uses questions based on survey is question based, yeah, a statistical survey to collect information about how people think and act. For example, a possible application of survey research to a business context might involve looking at how effective mass media is in helping form and shift public opinion. So mass media is like, you know, the media, any paper media, electronic media, whatsoever, they shift the public opinion. So you can do survey, yeah, that's a sociological investigation. That's also a kind of the research technique, yeah?
Yeah.
So research techniques, survey, you do surveys, you are doing research, you are doing something on mobile, you are doing something on the literature available from online research community, you interview someone, that's the research. Focus group are being asked the questions, you are doing some research, research desk, quantitative research, qualitative research, we discussed, and few more topics in, you know, like phenomenological research, we discussed historical research, yeah.
Yeah.
And many more we discussed in, you know, in this session today. You realize there were lots of research, isn't it?
A lot.
Yeah. So let us come to our last few topics. Now sampling. Yeah. The process of selecting a number of individuals for a study in such a way that the individuals represent the larger group from which they were selected. So do I need to continue these slides? You know, now there are about, you know, 5-6 slides, or maybe we complete tomorrow or, you know, in the next class. What do you say?
Okay.
I mean, you are free to attend, you know, continue now?
I am free, but I don't know how many slides. It's like 6 slides?
Yeah.
Or maybe we continue from the next, from here, we complete it next Saturday and or Sunday.
Okay, that's fine, you know. We will spend some time on these slides and, you know, we will be touching the learning outcome 2 from the next class. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So any other question from the previous slides you want to ask?
No. Go forward.
Yeah. Or if you want, I can complete this. It really depends on you.
No, you go ahead if you want. I'm looking at your own time. If you have that design, we can just rush through it. I think they are all mostly theory based. I can, after
Yeah.
going through, go back to read again.
Sorry. So you want me to continue? Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Now sampling. Sampling is basically, for example, you surveyed, 1,000 people, and you want to study kind of, only 10 people. You want to study, let's say, 80 people. Yeah, that's the sampling. You have a data, for example, for the 1,000 people, and you want to, take some sample. It says process of selecting a number of individuals for a study in such a way that the individuals represent the larger group from which they were selected. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Sampling is like a, even you have, let's say you can confidently say that you have surveyed like 10,000, people, and obviously you will not be giving the thoughts of 10,000, but you would select, probably hundreds. So one type is probability based. A probability sampling method is any method of sampling that utilizes some form of random selection. Simply, you randomly select and you conclude, you analyze the data. Is that clear?
Yeah.
So they are self-explanatory, and you can find the examples and more definitions in these slides. But the first line is basically the main thing which I will be reading for you. Yeah?
Okay.
Selective. The purpose of sampling. The purposive sampling, known as judgmental, selective, or subjective sampling, is a type of non-probability sampling technique. Non-probability sampling focuses on sampling technique where the units that are investigated are based on judgment for the researcher. So whatever you judge, for example, you surveyed 10 areas and you think that two of the areas you will have a complete and accurate information, you did a selective sampling. Clear?
Sure.
Convenience based sampling, also known as availability sampling, is a specific type of non-probability sampling. It's a kind of, again, the selective, sampling that relies on data collection from population members who are conveniently available to participate in the, study. So, for example, you have this population and you are convenient that you can take this sampling from this. Simple. Clear?
Yeah.
Ethnographic methods. Yeah. So, ethnography is a study through direct observation of users in their natural environment rather than in a lab. The objective of this type of research is to gain insights into how users interact with things. We discussed this ethnographic method earlier. Here is the sampling technique, like a data collection technique, which is watch or being part of social context. Open and closed questions that cover identified topics. Open questions that enable a free development of a conversation. Anything from artifacts to letters, books, or reports. So we were discussing on the sampling techniques in ethnographic methods. The data collection technique, is done in these four ways. Okay.
Yeah.
So we revise, we discussed the sampling technique simply. So those were like a probability, selective, and convince. And again, in the ethnographic research, the sampling technique that you can use is this basically. Watch are being part of social context, open and closed questions, and these things. So we are just, trying to see if I ask you the question, that what is the sampling technique in the ethnographic methods, you would answer these four. Maybe you use in your computing research or not, but the sampling technique into the ethnographic methods is this four points. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, ethics and research. You know, the ethics, it is most important that you should do your research under certain ethics. Research ethics is defined here to be the ethics of planning, conducting, and reporting of research, such as social responsibility, human rights, animal welfare, compliance with the law, and public and health safety. Are you clear about what the ethics are in the research?
Yeah, I am clear.
Yeah, you should be clear, yeah. It is clear that research ethics should include the protection of human and animal. Simple. It is under the ethics that you should do the research on human and animals according to certain ethics and permission and the law. However, not all researchers use human or animal subjects, nor are the ethical or the ethical dimensions of the research confined solely to protection for the research subject. So ethics is very much clear to you. Yeah?
Yeah.
So challenges in the ethics, like a collection, use and interpretation of the data. So any data that you want to deal, certain, you know, challenges are there. Collection of data, use of data, methods, relationships among the researchers, and from where you get the information, whether you can do the research on particular topic or not. For example, can you do the research in the atomic energy? Maybe not. Yeah. Maybe you need to be, you know, to take a bond. Yeah. And maybe the government may not allow you to do the research, isn't it?
Sure.
Principles, beneficence, to do good, non-maleficence, yeah, to do no harm, respect for autonomy, fairness, truthfulness, and justice. So what is the main principle of the ethics? That it should be able to do good. Do not harm anyone. It should be independent. It should be fair, truthful, and justice. Ethics approval is gaining the ethical approval on research before starting it. So data analysis techniques, we discussed like qualitative methods and qualitative and quantitative methods. Yeah. So the qualitative deals with the ideas and the quantitative deals with the numbers. Now, the last topic is data analyzing tools. The data analyzing tools is the processing of, the data analysis is basically the process of inspecting, cleansing, transforming, and modeling data with the goal of discovering useful information, suggesting conclusions, and supporting decision making. What are the data analysis tools? They help you to inspect, cleansing, and transform the data. Can you give any example of the data analysis tool? For example, if you have thousands of, you know, data, yeah, thousands of records, then obviously it would be difficult to manage. You use certain tools in order to analyze it, like list of non-programming tools, Excel sheet. You put the data into the Excel, you see the data into the graphs.
Yeah.
Yeah. So like other software, Trific, they are the commercial one. We don't need to stick on any one. Like these are just name, RapidMiner, Rattle GUI, like Weka, many more, SPFF. Have you heard about the SPFF?
SPFF? No.
Yeah, SPSS.
No.
So there are lots of data analyzing tools in the computing as well as the social research. Really depends which one do you use, but they help you to inspect, cleanse, transform, analyze, model the data. so that you discover the useful information, you suggest the conclusions and take the decisions. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's it. We are done. And almost, you know, we covered every concept. I don't think so. We have left anything unexplained, isn't it?
Yeah, this learning outcome one.
Yeah, that was the learning outcome one. So learning outcome one is fully, you know, discussed into 36 slides. Discuss the quantitative methods, qualitative methods, the sampling techniques, the research, you know, techniques, define the research, you know, its definitions and, you know, some examples, limitations and advantages. That was about the learning outcome one. Yeah. So that's it. We end the session today and we will discuss the next session, you know, next weekend. Yeah.
All right.
All right then. Bye. Thank you.
Bye bye. Thank you.